of the Halter 200.
Well, this is it, an offshore powerboat, and this is the cockpit. Looks pretty comfortable in here right now, but when you're going 90 miles an hour out in an ocean that doesn't like you, it just doesn't feel the same way. You'll notice that we have three seats in here. We call them bolsters. And the reason we do that and call them bolsters are because you have to kind of put yourself back because of the G-forces that you experience when the boat leaps out. It's hard to explain right now. The only way I could relate to it is a few years ago we had an astronaut go for a ride. And he sat down and calculated it. He figured that one offshore powerboat received more G-forces than all the astronauts in the history of man have ever received taking off from this Earth. That's just in one race. Well, let's look at what we've got here. We've got a steering wheel. Sounds pretty simple. You can drive the boat and do everything else, but you really can't. You need two hands to drive this boat because you've got about 2,000 horsepower on the back end telling you to go two different ways. So you have another man right here, and his job is to run the throttles. Right here we have about 2,000 horsepower, and as he pushes it forward, he revs the motors and increases or decreases the speed, just like you hear in the background when they're revving it back and forth. On this side we have a navigator, and his only job is to find themselves all the time. And it gets a little hectic getting your brains beat out and still trying to remember at 2.5 minutes you should be at point A and at 7 minutes at point B. It's tough being an offshore racer. Okay, this is the business end of an offshore powerboat. As you can see here, we're preparing to put on a set of props. The lower units, the aluminum unit here, is what we call a Speedmaster unit. It's designed to cut through the water at incredible speeds without creating turbulence, so the prop can get maximum efficiency. The props, by the way, are made in Italy, and you'll see that as they're not tightened by torque, but rather by the feel of the mechanic that does it. This is where it all comes through. If there's no power to this point, nothing happens.
Two-time U.S. national champion Joel Halpern of Tarrytown, New York, was fatally injured in a pre-race collision in the staging area. The Michelob Light catamaran and the Popeyes Deep V collided. Halpern died of massive head injuries shortly after it being admitted to Charity Hospital in New Orleans. But the race went on, and none of the drivers knew that this tragic accident had taken place until after the completion of the Halter 200, in which only 14 boats finished the race.
About the only thing on this motor that you might recognize is an orange valve cover. But from that point on, it's strictly business. Over here, rather than one carburetor, we have what's called Kinzler injection. It's specially designed for offshore because the stacks have to be at a certain tuned height. That brings the gas in. When it's mixed up with this monster down here, it gets pumped out through here. These are what we call Patterson headers. They're special tuned headers, and as you can see, they're all chrome, but they might look good, but they're strictly business also. They run straight out the back, and there's a lot of water flowing through this motor.
Michelle Maynard of Concord, Massachusetts, driving his wooden 38-foot Cougar catamaran, Fave Issues, grabbed the checkered flag in the Offshore 1 category. His winning average speed of 80.2 miles per hour was well under the expected 90 mile per hour average expected for this event. Maynard, the defending 1980 world champion, finished the Halter 200 4 minutes ahead of defending Halter 200 champion Betty Cook in Cayma. Pete Marzano of Pompano Beach, Florida, captured the Offshore 2 championship in his Merck Cruiser-powered 30-foot Velocity Targa. Vince had a chance to talk to the crew of Targa right after the race.
Well, first of all, congratulations, needless to say.
Thank
we want to congratulate all of you.
Thank you.
You did a heck of a job out there. Listen, we don't understand this. The speeds were way down from what we thought. Was it a lot rougher out there than you thought?
It sure was. It was
very choppy. There was a lot of wind, and I think it was very rough.
What about controlling the boat? Did you have a problem?
On two of the legs, where it got exceptionally rough, what we did is we ran off course just to get into some good water.
Get into some good water.
Yeah.
Well, earlier in the, earlier here, we talked about the fact that it was a lake and that we didn't have too much to worry about. Do you think we've just put Lake Pontchartrain on a different level?
By all means.
Hello, everybody. I'm Jim Hendrick, and this is the Michelob Light Grand Bahama 200, and a small field it is. In fact, we say the Grand Bahama 200, but in fact, it's less than 180 miles because they've shortened the course because of rough water. In fact, because of rough water, we're down to only 18 boats. Some 15 were stranded over in the mainland in Miami and could not make it over for this race. We'll have the start of this event, the exciting start, and follow the Michelob Light Grand Bahama 200 in just a moment. Back here at Freeport, Lakaya, the Grand Bahama Islands, it's the Michelob Light Grand Bahama, the start of the Open Class 1, and referee Ed Nabb has dropped the flag, and we are underway. All the boats are bunched up at the start, and with me is a veteran throttle man and former driver in the Open Class 1. His name is Sammy James from Fort Lauderdale, Florida, and we're going to draw upon your expert opinions throughout this race, Sammy. And tell us right now what's going on in the minds of the throttle men and the drivers and navigators as they just start an event such as this.
Well, you start out, Jim, trying to feel each other out, and everybody's kind of tucked in there. What we mean is the outdrives are trimmed in under. The flaps are down on the back of the boat, which control the attitude of it. And you're just kind of watching your competitor and see how hard he's willing to run at this position in the race.
Bunched up right now as we just get underway is the Ajax Hawk, who won this event last year, driven by Jerry Jacoby. This is the Michelob Light, driven by Betty Cook from Southern California. And the Satisfaction takes a slight lead over the Michelob Light. The Satisfaction driven by Paul Clauser of North Miami Beach. And as they come up along the oil tankers along this part of the course, a rookie, number 20, the Apache, driven by Jerry Kilpatrick of St. Augustine, Florida, is running right up with the pack. And let me ask you this, Sammy, how can a rookie do so well? Get right up there with the big guys.
That's an easy answer. It's Bob Sassini's in there running the throttles, and he's been at it for many years, and he knows how to trim the boat and throttle it just right to keep right up there with the Michelob.
This is the Michelob Light. It's driven by Betty Cook, who has won many world championships and, of course, national crowns and many, many races. She's quite a gal. She's often said that her crew wins the race. All she does is steer. Right now, Jerry Jacoby and the Ajax Hawk, the winner of this event last year, is now leading the pack, and Betty Cook and the Michelob Light coming up the challenge. Back in third and fourth is the Satisfaction with Paul Clauser of North Miami and the rookie we were just talking about, Jerry Kilpatrick, in the Apache. And on the top of your screen coming up the challenge for third is Ed Trotta of Fort Lauderdale, Florida. That's the Rampage. As we watch that Rampage get a little out of shape, it looks like a chime walk. What causes that?
Well, we call it 3 to 5 with an occasional surprise. You get the boat trimmed to run in a certain water condition, and then all of a sudden you hit a hole out there. And that boat will take off and go right to the moon with you.
Offshore racing actually is a test track for many pleasure boats that are designed just like this by the many builders. And here's the Ajax Hawk with Jerry Jacoby of Old Westbury, New York, the winner of this event last year. We ask him what it takes to make a winning team.
Well, it really takes three, the navigator and the throttle man, of course. The throttle man's importance in the boat is actually keeping the attitude of the boat and the boat keep going in a good line. And the navigator has to tell us where we're going, of course. And without
what about your throttle man? Who is he?
Keith Hazel. Keith ran before with me since last year. Before that, he ran with Flapjack and came in second nationally. And Keith came aboard on the second race of last year. And I hadn't won a race until Keith came aboard. And after that, we won two races last year.
And what about your navigator?
Bart has been with me since...
Bart who?
Bart Quarton has been with me since the inception of the team. In fact, the Ajax Hawk, our 37.5-foot cigarette, was designed by Bart, and the boat is a very, very good boat. In fact, it is a prototype of that type of boat.
Betty, your reaction when Bernie Little asked you to drive for his team?
I must admit, I was a little bit overwhelmed, but I think more importantly, I was terribly flattered to be asked.
Will this help you with your career?
Oh, indeed. It will help me a great deal. It's the fact that it's a really well-known and well-recognized racing operation with which I am now associated, and certainly that gives me a stature that probably I didn't have before.
We are at the east end of the Grand Bahama Islands. This is all that's left of an offshore four-class racer, the Seahawk 2. The crew is okay, Sammy, but look at that boat.
Yeah, this is one of the things that we dread the worst, is a fire on board, because you're either going to get your feet wet or get burnt, and there ain't much choice between the two.
But the race goes on now. He's coming right under our helicopter. Our cameras will have to wait till he comes out and swings out, and he takes the lead with 2 minutes to go to the end of this race. The Apache, a rookie driver, Jerry Kilpatrick from St. Augustine, Florida, is going to win this race if he can keep it going.
I think he's going to do it, Jim. He's going to bring her on home first.
That's boat racing. You never know till the last mile, and that checkered flag, of course, is waiting. Well, that checkered flag is waiting on the finish boat right now. A very happy crew, and you can see that they're signaling each other. Look, see? They're saying, there's the checkered flag. It's waiting for us. We're going to win this one. It's going to be our first victory ever, and what a thrill for a rookie. Coming around now, that is the finish boat with the checkered flag flying, and as we said, the crew of the Apache takes the checkered flag to victory.
Well, that's a happy crew there, Jim. I know the feeling.
And I imagine you know the feeling that Betty Cook and the likes of Jerry Jacoby and Paul Claus and the rest of the gang that had problems today, you know their feeling too.
Yeah, but second's better than a sharp stick in the eye.
That's right, Sammy, because in this case, Betty Cook picks up 300 points for a second-place finish and maintains a slight lead in the National High Point race. Jerry Jacoby finishes third in the Ajax Hawk after a valiant try. In the Offshore Class 3, Randy Sosa of Miami drove his Man of War to victory. Offshore Class 4, defending national champion Dave Alpert of Tampa, took first-place flag in the Can-Do today. And Gary Stewey of Oak Park, Illinois, brought his Nasty home first in the Offshore Class 2 race. And so the second annual Michelob Light Grand Bahama 200 is now history. Our thanks to Sammy James for his expert assistance on today's telecast. From Freeport, Grand Bahama, this is Jim Hendrick reporting.
This is the boat, a 32-foot Cobra called Renegade. It runs in the modified class, thus the letter designation M. There are four offshore powerboat classes, the largest being the open class, followed in order by sport class, the modified, then performance. The four sizes range from 40 feet down to 27. They all start out in a shop like this one. The molds are filled with Kevlar and fiberglass. Some boats are now being constructed of aluminum. A finished boat will cost anywhere from $50,000 to $200,000. It will cost that much to campaign a boat if it hopes to make all the national races. It is now Tuesday, April 7th, 11 days prior to the Bahamas race. The Renegade crew hopes to make that race. If it is to do so, work will continue late into the coming nights. After the hull was built, the boat came here to be outfitted. Shops like this one dot the South Florida coastline. They will finish the boat and get it race ready.
What we do is we incorporate all the features of the offshore boats into this miniature class, so to speak. There's not much difference in them, really, except for the size of the motors. And with this here, you know, it's the guy to be competitive and, you know, hopefully do well in this class.
Tomorrow, the engines will be delivered. On April 8th, the engines never arrived. Already falling behind schedule, work would continue where it could be done. It is now April the 10th. The engines were delivered, but the wrong engine mounts meant sending them back. Again, work continued, but now in the water testing at a place called Lake X in Central Florida looked to be but a 50-50 proposition. Saturday, April the 11th, 1 week before the Bahamas race. All that could be done is done. The engines arrive, much to the relief of the crew, but it appears that any testing to be done will have to be done here in South Florida, not in the more controlled environment of Mercury's test lake. On Sunday the 12th, it is less than 1 week before the race.
We've been in this position 10 times before.
A lot of overtime hours coming up.
It's common in this business. It's always the last minute. The boat's never really finished.
These engines will push this boat to speeds of up to 80 miles per hour. Speed is important, but that is not the big concern.
You don't have to be the fastest boat out there. You have to have a boat that stays together. The boat that finish, you know, wins the race usually. You have to finish first.
Tomorrow, the Renegade begins its all-too-brief testing period. Six days before the race, its twin 535-horsepower engines were installed. 3 days before the race, on Wednesday, the boat was hauled up to Mercury's Test Lake in Central Florida for initial test runs. Lack of a 20-inch prop precluded conclusive testing. But even more problems would lie ahead for Renegade. The very next day, April 16th, 2 days before the race, Renegade's crew members were beginning to feel the effects of 20-hour days. The boat would encounter further mechanical problems, but the capper was the weather itself. As the crew worked, the high seas would prevent any more boats from making the trip from Miami to the Bahamas. Renegade was out of luck and out of the race.
I would do it again just the way I did it before and push to make it. However, weather is something that is basically uncontrollable in our sport, so you have to kind of go with it as it comes.
The Renegade now had 3 weeks to gear up for the Bacardi race. That was the good news. But the residue of a missed Bahamas race remained.
It's also disappointing from the standpoint of national point standings. You want to make every race that you can, and this was a rather local race. It was close here. We didn't have to go a long distance to race it. We knew the waters, and it would have been very good for us had we been able to get into that race.
Renegade would enter Bacardi with no points, 700 points behind the modified class leader, Smokin. With 3 weeks to prepare for the Miami race, the crew decided to do some modification to the boat, changing the trim system for one, and
adding an additional cable to our steering system so that we had a backup steering system should the prime system go out.
That decision to install a backup would prove to be a lifesaver. With time to prepare, some tasks could be attended to with little worry about deadline pressure.
Yeah. I've already laid out a course of exactly where we're going. We're going to get a final decision on what the exact course is at the driver's meeting, but I have a fairly good idea of where we're going, how far it's going to take, and a very good idea of how long it's going to take us depending on what speed we're doing.
The day before the Bacardi race, a driver's meeting was held.
In all conditions when you're racing, please think safety first.
This will be the official finish boat. It will be at least a 40-foot sport fishing type.
For the very first time, the Renegade crew answered roll call.
M11, Renegade.
When we go out government cut with all those other boats, my heart's going to be going right out of my chest. I can't wait.
7 a.m., race day. In 1 hour, the final driver's meeting will take place. At 9:15, the boats will leave these docks at Turnberry.
Psyched up?
Between now and then, there is very little to do.
Good morning.
He's doing good, too.
We expect the wind to pick up just a little bit
to give us enough of a sea condition to make it more interesting.
What does it look like out there? Have you had a look?
Haven't had a look yet, but it looks like it's going to be pretty nice. The wind's down pretty well right now, and we'll have enough sea to get up in the air a little bit, and that's our kind of race anyway.
Somewhere between 50 and 70 boats will make the race. Right now, everyone is tinkering, mostly unnecessary, just trying to keep their minds off the task at hand. Bob Filippino is the one person responsible for making sure the boat runs, and what any crew member will tell you is most important, making sure the boat stays together. When it leaves the dock, his job is over, but not the worry.
The only concern of any racer or any crew chief really is if they have to shut down, then hopefully the starter will engage. That's our biggest problem. We can't get starters to hold up the way we should. You know, it can be a brand new starter and all of a sudden it's dead.
Something else to worry about. Still nowhere to be seen is the driver, Tom Mount. A roll call will be taken at the driver's meeting in a few minutes. If he's not there, it's a disqualification and another 3 week wait until the next race. At the final driver's meeting, procedures covered at yesterday's meeting are gone over again.
We talked yesterday, number one class is gonna start first. As you know, there's an imaginary line going across.
Finally, Tom shows up and the Renegade crew makes roll call.
M11, Renegade.
Smith.
Here.
The meeting lasts about 30 minutes. It seems like 30 days. It is now 15 minutes before the boats are due to leave the docks. Nothing else, the Renegade and its crew look good.
Well, after months of preparation and all the time and money and energy put into getting the boat race ready, it's still not time to race.
For the next 45 minutes, all boats will follow the pace boat from Turnberry to Government Cut, down the intercoastal to the starting point.
Rapano, clear this area.
At 10, the boats arrive at Government Cut and group together in their different classes. The race is about to begin. It is 10 a.m. The race boats already in the Government Cut Basin begin to group and circle in their designated areas. During the next 20 minutes, some crews will top off their fuel tanks, others will have little else to do but think about their impending journey. For the Class 1 boats, their course will stretch 200 miles from Government Cut to Bimini, back to the mainland to Hillsboro Inlet, down around the finish boat, back up to Hillsboro, and then the final run south to the finish line. The course for the Class 2, 3, and 4 boats, including Renegade, is shorter, 108 miles from Government Cut to Bimini to Port Everglades and south to the finish line. At 10:20, the pace boat and other official boats are having problems with the lost and curious.
There's a race patrol in this area. You will have to clear this area now.
20 minutes later, at 10:40, with the race boat still circling, the first flare is lit. A few minutes later, the yellow flag goes up as the Class 1 boats, the first boats to go off, head for the cut, maintaining an imaginary line 100 yards behind the pace boat. While the first start is in the process of getting underway, all other boats must wait, something not unfamiliar to the Renegade crew. In rapid succession, the Class 1 boats go off, followed by the Class 2 boats, both perfect starts. It is now Renegade's chance to prove her worth and durability, her crew's chance to prove their racing expertise and stamina. The wait is over. From the finish line, Renegade lost her hydraulic steering. A backup system saved the day. There was other damage as well.
As we went along, the bulkheads that were fiberglass in the boat all broke loose. Our trim indicators fell off. And a lot of minor damage like that. A lot of structural damage. But the engine has never missed a beat. The boat ran fantastic. We made it. So we're all very happy.
As well they should be. Renegade finished third in class.
Willie Diaz of Miami, Florida, in El Boss, unfortunately was disqualified when he did not bring the boat to mandatory inspection. Gary Stewie from Oak Brook, Illinois, received the sports class championship for the Bacardi race almost 24 hours after this finish. Maynard Gonzalez of Miami and Craig Mosley of Miami also had their first wins on the national circuit. Gonzalez drove Nightwing to the first place in the modified class, while Craig Mosley took the Pro Stock Championship in Fish Peddler. Eddie Trauda drove a 39-foot Kevlar cigarette named Rampage over the 203-mile course to win his first title in 2 years of racing at the Bacardi Trophy Race.
This is Cape Coral, Florida, the scene of the Sutphin International for offshore powerboat racing. 42 boats make up four different classes that are preparing to get underway off of Fort Myers Beach in the Gulf of Mexico. Hello, everybody. I'm Jim Hendrick, and this is the Sutphin Classic, the fourth race of the year for offshore powerboat racing. The boat I'm sitting on now is the Michelob Light, to be driven by Betty Cook and her crew. And, of course, swaddle man John Connors is going to have his work cut out for them. This boat and the other open boats will have to negotiate 208 rough miles in this Sutphin Classic. The other boats, classes 2, 3, and 4, will negotiate 104 miles, just half the distance. In just a moment, the exciting start and this Sutphin Classic race after this timeout. We are about to start the open class. Down at the starting boat, here is the voice of referee Steve Baum giving directions to his pace boat driver.
You're looking good. Looking a little faster. A little faster. You got that green flag ready?
I got it ready.
A little faster. A little faster. A little faster. You ready to get it?
The start is all important. They're watching for the green flag. That'll release them on their 208-mile journey. These are the biggest of the four classes. They're about to let them go.
Let them go!
The roar of the powerful engines as Open Class 1 starts out on their 208-mile speed journey. Meanwhile, Class 2, the sports class boats, are underway. Class 3 is also released, the modifieds. 42 boats in all, four different classes. Class 4, the pro stockers, are now beginning their competition. They fly down the slot past the spectator boats for their start. So all 42 in four classes are underway. Here's a man with plenty of experience. On the bow of that boat is US 1. That is symbolic to the fact that last season, he acquired more points in the season-long competition than any other boats in Open Class 1. He is U.S. 1, and that means national champion. He's currently riding fourth, while now the Michelob Light team is coming up to checkpoint 2. Coming down the slot, it is the Nasty first, New Horizons limped home second, the Targa, driven by Pete Marsano out of Pompano Beach, Florida, was overall third. Willie Falcon Seahawk out of Miami moved from fifth to first in national high point standings with a first place win in the pro stock class here in the Sutphin International. Lance Rubel in Manta was second. Pepe Nunez placed third in the Pantera. There's been over 100,000 spectators that have witnessed today's Sutphin International with over 1,000 spectator boats anchored around the course. And here is the coveted checker flag that they will take personally after it's autographed tonight in the white squares by all the other contestants. It'll hang proudly, I'm sure, in Betty Cook's den back in Newport Beach, California. And Bill Vogel, standing on the bow, the navigator, waiting to take that coveted flag. She'll be on her way to the bank with the team tomorrow, the better part of $35,000 in prize money, pocketed by the Michelob Light Racing Team. Of course, here comes our second place boat, Justin Paul Clauser of North Miami in the Satisfaction, and the Apache, Jerry Kilpatrick out of St. Augustine, Florida.
On our 6 o'clock report, Rick Schwartz, who was at the races from start to finish, told you there were no winners in the modified division. That's because all 11 boats were disqualified, and Rick will tell you why.
It was the offshore 3 class, the modified boats, that got into trouble. As their numbers suggest, the modified group with the third race to go off. The start of the race was fine, but it was about a mile and a half downrange that the trouble began. At that point, there was a marker boat that the racing boats were supposed to pass. It was close into shore, and the first two groups almost missed it themselves. Watch the boat with the black hull and black deck, the Pantera. She almost misses the white boat in the water. That's the marker boat, but she realizes her mistake and comes back to make the turn around the marker. Now watch as the modified boats come by the same point. There, way in the distance in the upper left-hand part of your screen is the same marker boat. So it would seem there is no controversy that the modified group did indeed miss the first marker point. But the driver that eventually came in first in the modified race, Paula Aiken with Smokin', says there's another way to look at it.
According to the rule book, all marks must be fixed points by buoys or, all checkpoints should be fixed buoys or landmarks. They didn't do it for this course, so as far as I'm concerned, they the commission are as wrong as we are by going on the wrong side. Also, it states under the protest that going on the wrong side of a check boat stipulates a 3-minute penalty, not a disqualification. And I think that the commission should be willing to bend as much as the modified class, because we all did it together as a team.
Chief referee Stan Fitz says a rule is a rule, and the modified boats are all disqualified.
All the boats were not identified at the first checkpoint, and under Rule 7 in the rule book, they are disqualified. I think a lot of this, you get into interpretation, but I think also we have four classes running, and two of the classes ahead of them and one of the classes after them negotiated the checkpoint properly. This was a good indication of how the mark was.
Even if we are disqualified, if God has it that way, that's all right. We'll still come back. It was a great race.
From the Sutphin International Powerboat Race in Cape Coral, Rick Schwartz, WINK Sports.
And so the offshore powerboats are still until the next starting gun. And over 100,000 spectators have had their first look at this exciting water speed sport in the Cape Coral, Fort Myers area. Our congratulations to the winners, and better luck next time to the guys and gals who brave the elements to compete. On behalf of Sammy James, who supplied the technical input and other commentary on today's telecast, this is Jim Hendrick. So long.
is an offshore ocean powerboat race site. But amazingly enough, it's being done in Detroit, Michigan, which is pretty far inland. Detroit has been host to powerboat races for many, many, many years. What in this country is known as unlimited racing. And the names of Bill Munsey and Dean Chenoweth are like cornflakes and yogurt. And we arrived 3 years ago, much to their amazement and horror, and blew away the lake and blew away the river. Michigan itself has been the scene of offshore powerboat races for many, many years, too, mostly in Lake St. Clair, some in Lake Michigan itself. But never before has it been done on the river. The river in Detroit encompasses both Canada and the U.S. This particular race starts on the Canadian border. It goes out along the river, goes back into the U.S., around the lake on the Canadian side, back down the U.S. side. So it's really, in a sense, you know, an international race. Most of the boats here are known widely throughout the world because they've raced internationally before. There's Bill Elswick's Long Shot, which you all know. There's Ted Tolman's Cat. There is Paul Clauser's Cat. And unfortunately today, I don't have a cat. I wish I did because I think it would be a good race for a cat. And I'm sure they're going to finish like 1, 2, or 3. Hopefully the best we can do is the best we can do. And I hope that's good enough at least to finish the race.
And so, 2.25 hours after it began, and with an average speed of 80 miles an hour, Betty Cook in Michelob Light wins the Spirit of Detroit race and extends her lead in the world's most spectacular and prestigious series, the American Offshore Powerboat Championship.
Bill's got a sports cast that's out of a life in the fast lane tonight. Bill, take it away.
Thank you, Don. The 7th annual Benihana Grand Prix powerboat race today off Point Pleasant. You could not have asked for a better day. Here's what it looked like high above the Atlantic Ocean, and the race was underway shortly after 10 a.m. There were four classes of competition in today's race. The open class competed over a 208-mile course, and the three modifieds ran 119 miles. Betty Cook, in her Michelob Light, was the favorite to win the open class, but the defending national champion saw her Benihana jinx continue. She has never won here, and she finished third today. But Cook still leads the 1981 point standings. The winners, Paul Clauser in the open class in Satisfaction. Class 2, Lou Cooper in Miss Gallo Wine. Class 3, John Sheehan in Bush. And Class 4, Vincent Rinaldi in Rolling Thunder. That all-New Jersey crew entered in the open class. Roger Mahan's Pleasure Seeker, who we profiled last Friday, did not finish. Last year's Benihana Open winner Bill Elswick in Long Shot was fifth. That husband-wife team, Ron and Paula Aiken, who we profiled last night, did not finish in their Class 3 race. While the overall fleet was down from last year's record number of 77, 59 boats started this morning in the Benihana Grand Prix, still making this the largest offshore powerboat race in the world. And for the winner in the open class, it was a question of smooth sailing. With the water extremely smooth, it was a day for catamarans in that open class. Longshot and Arneson battled for the first half of the race, but Paul Clauser and Satisfaction took over and led most of the way in the stretch. Clauser brought two boats with him today. He entered them both and chose the Cat when the conditions came up smooth.
Why were you the only guy smart enough to bring two boats and therefore be able to make the decision before race time?
I guess maybe it's been a long time coming and we decided we're going to do it. We have to. I've been racing 3 years, my first victory.
Now, you're third in the overall points this year. Can you catch Betty Cook coming off this win?
Sure. I'll make it a double win next race.
Louis J. Cooper, Miss Gallo Wine. Lou, let me ask you, you're our senior in racing, and you're a little bit older. Does it hurt you any more than it hurts us?
Well, I'm not so sure I like being called older, but I had my 65th birthday last August. But I've been around racing since I was 19 years old. I started in outboards. I started in the wine business as a wholesale distributor in Detroit in 1946. Gallo has been one of my major suppliers all of these years, and they are now helping me to sponsor my racing activities. Last year and the previous years, I raced in the modified class. This year, we decided to go all the way and go up to the sports class, which is the fastest class and the one that finishes the race first.
Thanks, Lou.
As you can see, age has nothing to do with offshore powerboat racing.
These are offshore powerboats. They're capable of reaching speeds of just over 100 miles per hour. And at that velocity, they're in the air more than they're on the water. Of all the drivers, both male and female, the best is Californian Betty Cook, a petite, likable, 58-year-old grandmother of three. She drives the 10,000-pound, 1,400-horsepower Michelob light boat, replacing a driver who was killed in a race earlier this year.
It's because of the challenge, and it's a lot of challenges. It's an intellectual challenge, it's a physical challenge, it's a technical challenge, it's a team working together, and the sense of satisfaction one gets just from finishing is enormous.
In each 200-mile race, 60% of the boats never finish, mostly because of mechanical failures. But with a strong commitment from Michelob Light, both engines in the boat are replaced every race, and Betty's yet to have a breakdown. So with superior equipment and the help of her navigator and her throttle man, the other two in the boat, Betty has won the American title twice, the world title twice, and she holds the world record for the fastest average speed during a race, 86 miles an hour. In the past 4 years, she's won 14 races, and this year alone, she's placed first or second in 5 of 7 races. Today's race is one of the last for this season. Betty must do well to retain her first place in the standings. It'll be an extra challenge today because it's the first ever to be held on choppy, unpredictable Lake Michigan, and practically everything must be taped down on the boat. Like Betty, most drivers are used to the rolling swells of the oceans, which are more maneuverable.
I think Lake Michigan could be as dangerous as any other body. You have to have a basic respect for water.
Just how dangerous is offshore racing? At 90 or 100 miles per hour, death and injuries are not uncommon. In a race earlier this year, Betty herself bounced so hard in the waves that she broke a rib with her own elbow.
I have absolute confidence and never question the guys that are with me. If they tell me to do something, I do it, and I do it right now. I don't really think about the danger of it. If I get to a point where there's a situation that I can't handle, slow down. You know, people are more important than boats.
Yellow flag, radar reflector, flare gun and kit, orange smoke flares, sea diamond.
Race officials try to minimize the dangers with stringent requirements. These precautions help, but no matter how prepared you are, a 90-mile-an-hour boat trip is considered a high risk. With the spectator fleet in place right next to the 200-mile course, the $35,000 race began and all eyes were on Betty Cook. As in most races, Betty stays off to the side in the beginning.
I get apprehensive about starts races when the boats are all clustered together and everybody's racing for the same checkpoint. You know, that always is cause for some concern, let's say. You're too busy doing your job ever to think about the creature comforts so much, you know, the fact that you're getting sick, you're getting nervous. You don't have time to do that.
Racing is a way of life for Betty Cook, and when she's not racing, she's developing racing engines. She's also active in California politics, and she's discovered a new love, tennis. Her lifestyle at 58 is admired by many, including her competitors.
She's just a heck of a racer.
It's very frustrating because here we are out in a sport that's supposedly a macho sport and running out in the ocean in 4 and 5 and 6 foot waves, and you turn around or you look in front of you and there's Betty Cook right alongside of you, and I really give her a lot of credit.
After running neck and neck for the lead in the first half of the race, Betty poured it on at the halfway point to eventually win, nearly clinching another American title. She hung on to the end, in spite of conditions that grew worse in the second 100 miles.
I don't like Lake Michigan. You can have Lake Michigan.
Why don't you like Lake Michigan?
Well, I think it's kind of rough.
Really?
Yeah, a little bit punishing today. It got rougher, and that last 20 miles, I thought, never, never, never end.
In spite of ice packs on her bruised elbows and blisters from steering, Betty's thoughts were on the upcoming world championships.
You know, no one's ever won 3 world championships.
You're going to be the first.
I would like very much to be the first.
With me, the winning team of the Michelob Light Chicago 200 Offshore 4 race, and it's Dave Albert and Can Do. And Dave, it had to be rough out there. That could have been the roughest seas we've seen this year.
It was a son of a gun.
What was it like out there? Somebody mentioned it was something like 8 to 10 foot rollers in a washing machine.
Yeah, it certainly was. The roughest it was down at Michigan City. And boy, going around that checkpoint, we just were climbing mountains down there.
What about the race itself? How did it look? How did you start off? And were you following anybody? Did you make any moves at any certain point of the navigational leg to take the lead?
No, not necessarily. It was just today, and as in any rough race, it's just the guy that holds together the best and has the biggest boat that can take the roughest water is going to win. Rolling Thunder and myself and Shogun, we all ran side by side going over to Michigan City. Unfortunately, Vinny Jr. Broke his foot, and Shogun broke his leg, so that put us in the first place, in which we kept it for the remainder of the race.
Another thing that put you in first place was first place on the National High Point Championship Trail, and put you over 200 points into first place in that spot with only one race left. You think you can hold it?
I sure hope so. That's where I like to be.
Chris, what about you? How did you feel out there?
I felt really good, and it was a long time since we won the Bahamas, and it felt really good to win again. You know, we really, together as a team, we really worked together really well today.
What about the boat? How did it perform compared to other races?
It was just unbelievable out there in that rough water. Just stays on top of them. We just keep throttling down. David, just stay together.
Okay. The magician. So the magicians come in, finishing first place in the Michelob Light Chicago 200. The Michelob Light Chicago 200 is now history, and 8 to 10 foot rollers on Lake Michigan made life rough for the 34 entrants, but Jerry Jacoby won the storm-shortened 121-mile race in the open class, piloting his Ajax Hawk to first place, his first win on the 1981 National Offshore Circuit. Also winning in today's event, in Offshore 2, Bob Erickson in Higher Power, in Offshore 3, Man of War, driven by Randy Sosa of Miami, Florida, and in Offshore 4, Dave Albert in Can Do. From Chicago, the Michelob Light Chicago 200.
Clouser from North Miami Beach, Florida, driving his 41-foot Cougar catamaran Satisfaction, came through with one of his most satisfying races in his offshore career, winning the Harbortown Trophy race and capturing the prestigious Harmsworth Trophy in the process. Clouser averaged 78.5 miles per hour over the 208-mile course in the Atlantic Ocean. In sport class, Dan Weinstein from Fort Lauderdale, Florida, drove Power Play to first place. It was Weinstein's first win on the national circuit this year. Willie Diaz of Miami in El Boss was second, with Humberto Bican in Dam Carrera in third. Chuck Jepson from Miami, Florida, drove his Shadow catamaran Lovett to its second win of the 1981 season. Jepson fought it out with Bobby Shear in Shear Terra for the Offshore 3 title. John Sheehan of Plymouth, Massachusetts, took third in Bush. In Offshore 4, Lance Rubel from Pembroke Pines, Florida, in Manta, is the official winner in the Pro Stock category. The race itself belonged to Lee Bomar from Mount Clemens, Michigan, in his active Kevlar catamaran Wolverine. Bomar led the race from the start until mechanical failure sidelined his craft only 7 miles from the finish. Steve Stepp of Pompano Beach, Florida, in his Velocity Hall named Velocity, took second, with Jerry Kilpatrick from St. Augustine, Florida, finishing third in his Kevlar Squadron Apache. Michelle Maynard from Concord, Massachusetts, returned to the national circuit after a 7-race hiatus, but his 34-foot catamaran disintegrated on the first lap. Maynard and throttleman Bob Adoni were pulled out from the water with minor bumps and bruises.